This presentation is brought to you by the Beljalski Foundation. Over 50 years of research towards curing cancer the natural way.
Did you guys know that most, if not all, disease processes start with inflammation? So inflammation is a very important topic, and there's good things, and there's bad things, and there's ugly things, and we're going to talk a little bit about it because we only have 18 minutes, and it's a very, very big topic. It is very closely related to digestive health, and we'll touch on that as well. So just a little bit of business. This is obviously for educational purposes only and not medical advice, and I'm sure you're here just to learn. And if you'd like medical advice, please consult your physician, and then let's get started. So this is me. This is my other job. This is where I'm a regular doctor, where I do procedures in an OR and an endoscopy center in a hospital. And I'll tell you a little bit about how I got here and where I started. So I wanted to be a doctor since I was 2 years old, and I have a photo of myself when I was three examining a doll with my grandmother's stethoscope. So I knew that I wanted to be a doctor, and it found me and it called me, and it wasn't my choice. And I was very excited to become a specialist. And most of my life, I did not want to go into integrative medicine. I didn't really even know what it was. So I did my residency. Residency is training after medical school in St. Vincent's Hospital. Some of you may know what it is or have heard of it. It was a pretty well-known hospital that stood in the West Village for many years. It was one of the oldest hospitals in New York. It was the main hospital for the Titanic, for 9/11. It was one of the biggest HIV centers at one point, but unfortunately it closed 2 months before I graduated. So you can imagine it was a very stressful process, and I wasn't feeling well. I was generally prone to allergies, and throughout my life I was allergic to environmental things, pets, but it was usually controllable with a mild antihistamine, but now it was really bad. And I was really, my eyes were very itchy, my head was congested, I was exhausted, and I was taking the maximum dose of antihistamines, and I was doubling it, and it was not touching me. So what happened to me is what happens to a lot of doctors who realize that Western medicine doesn't cure all. So I started going to a holistic practitioner in a place called Nerofe Wellness, and I started learning about my digestive health and how it affects all sorts of things, including allergies. And I learned I had leaky gut. I learned it was caused from stress. I learned that food is a very important part of the healing process. And after 3 weeks, I was completely off the antihistamines. And that was probably about 8 years ago that I've never taken antihistamine since that time. So now we're going to get into inflammation. So what is it? So inflammation is a good thing. It was designed by our body to fight off infection. And if you notice, when you have a cut, it feels warm and it feels swollen, or when you have a bruise. And that is part of the normal inflammatory process. Any type of physical trauma, infection, it draws the blood to the site to allow for the inflammatory or immune cells, which can be used interchangeably, to help to draw them to the area where they're needed the most. So it is an important part of healing. In fact, if you fever is an example of a normal inflammatory process. It is caused by our immune system to increase our body temperature. Since certain bugs don't live at certain temperatures, it actually helps kill the bugs. So what's the bad thing about inflammation? Is that when it becomes chronic, we want the acute inflammatory process. If we don't have it, we would have to live in a bubble. But the problem is when it becomes long-term. How does that happen? So let's say you have an infection, and something close to my heart, because I treat it all the time, is bowel infections. So let's say you caught a bug in Mexico and it caused you to have severe diarrhea and vomiting and fevers. And you took an antibiotic for it. And the antibiotic killed the bug about 90% of the way, or 95, or 99%. And you have a small amount left. You don't feel horribly ill, but your body is constantly on guard fighting that small amount of infection. And we now know that that irritable bowel can present as post-infectious IBS, meaning the body is still fighting off an infection that doesn't appear to be there anymore. The same can be applied to inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's and colitis and other autoimmune disorders when the body is constantly on guard, not at the same level of the acute infection, but at a low level. So what happens? This chronic inflammatory process causes damage to the digestive system, to the wall of the gut, and it alters the bacteria in the gut or the gut microbiome or microbiota, and chronic inflammation is associated with any type of disease process. Heart disease, we now know, is caused by inflammation. Liver disease is caused by inflammation. Digestive illnesses are caused by inflammation. Even Alzheimer's and any type of neurologic disorders are associated with inflammation. So we want the acute inflammatory process, but we want it to end when the organism is destroyed, and when the acute process is over, we want it to be over. So that's the inflammatory process. So Hippocrates, who is considered the father of Western medicine, he says all disease begins in the gut. And we can see how that logically makes sense, because the digestive system is the entry point for anything outside that we bring into our body. We break it down, we absorb it, we take the good, and we eliminate the bad. So in essence, everything that we take in our body needs to go through a very important system for it to be utilized properly and give us the good and not give us the bad. So this is a little cartoon about the organisms that live in and outside of our body. So the gut microbiome actually refers to the DNA of the organisms that live all over us, on our skin, in our mouths, in our digestive tract. We speak a lot about the gut microbiota, which are the organisms that live in the gut. They are highly concentrated in the large intestine, and right now the gut microbiome or microbiota is now at the forefront of research for almost every disease process. So a large part of our immune system is located in the digestive tract, and the bacteria communicate with the immune system in the digestive tract, and the good bacterial populations are associated with a strong immune system, and they help us fight infection and maintain our immune system in the proper state so that we don't develop autoimmune diseases such as Crohn's, colitis, arthritis, and all those. So what happens when we have something called dysbiosis, which is abnormal bacterial populations? So there's many things that occur. Something called leaky gut, which we probably have all heard of. We call it increased intestinal permeability, which basically means the wall of the intestine is porous and it allows things to get in that are not supposed to get into the body from the digestive tract. The digestive tract is almost considered outside of the body, and it protects the inside of the body by a wall that becomes more permeable when it is affected by chronic inflammation. So the bacteria are also a big part of mental health. So we have trillions of bacteria that live in our gut, and they communicate with our brain. They help synthesize neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters are brain chemicals that we use to communicate between brain cells. And in fact, if you've heard of serotonin, which is a neurotransmitter that is associated with happiness and fulfillment and is actually a target in many antidepressant medications called SSRIs, selective serotonin receptor reuptake inhibitors, 90% of it is made in the digestive tract, and it is made by the bacteria. So the bacteria in the gut play a very, very important role. So how do we talk, how do we put out the fire of inflammation? So one important thing that I'm going to talk about in the next talk is the gut-brain connection. So it is very important to address the emotional stress associated with digestive issues. The digestive tract has more neurologic connections to the brain than any other system. That is in addition to the bacteria synthesizing neurotransmitters. So it makes sense that we feel butterflies in our stomach and we have a gut feeling because the brain and the gut are very intimately connected. So in fact, many gastroenterologists and many integrative doctors will tell you it's very hard to control symptoms of things like irritable bowel, for example, when the stress is not managed. Second most important thing, or maybe first most important thing, is a proper diet. So which diet do, how do we eat, and what do we eat, and which diet? And there's so many diets, and there's so many names, and there's the Candida diet, and the Mediterranean diet, and the low FODMAP diet. And there seems to be a diet for everything, and everyone you go to tells you to eat another diet. So what do we do? How do we eat? So first of all, everyone's different and everyone's unique, and everyone needs to eat what they need to eat for their body at the right time. But there are certain things that are universal. High-quality foods apply to everybody. We cannot eat processed foods and expect our gut health, our mental health, and our overall health to thrive. We have to eat good, high-quality ingredients, and almost every diet will say that vegetables are good. Some diets will say you need more animal protein, and some diets will say you need more fiber and starches, and some diets will say to eliminate fruit, but vegetables are always good. How else are we going to put out that fire? Exercise. So exercise is not just a physical process. It's highly important to manage emotional stress. It's actually been shown to improve cognitive function in Alzheimer's disease and prevent cognitive decline. So exercise is not just for building muscles in the gym. It's a vital part of overall health. So I touched upon leaky gut, which is increased intestinal permeability, which is very closely related to abnormal bacterial populations in the gut. So how does that occur, and how can we treat that? So the standard American diet, or SAD, the SAD diet, it's very sad, it's inevitable to have leaky gut if we follow what most Americans eat, unfortunately. So another important factor is that we should really be getting our nutrients from food. So again, emphasizing that high quality foods are always best. But sometimes we do need some supplements, and there are some products that are known to treat leaky gut better than others. For example, glutamine, bovine colostrum, and in my own practice, sometimes we use mixed Chinese herbs. How do we repopulate the microbiome? People think that probiotic, you take a probiotic and you have healed your dysbiosis. It's just a drop in the bucket. Because we have so many populations of bacteria, taking a probiotic can help. The best way, in my opinion, to get your good bacterial populations in your gut is through fermented food. Fermented food serve as a probiotic in that they have the bacterial populations, and a prebiotic. A prebiotic is the fiber-rich source of food for bacteria that allows them to grow. We spoke about, so this is my practice, and I'll tell you a little bit about what we do to treat inflammation. Pretty much all our patients are inflamed, and probably most people who have any digestive issues or any other health issues have some level of inflammation in their body. We treat all patients as unique individuals and not diagnoses, because two people with irritable bowel or two people with Crohn's or two people with ulcerative colitis are not the same. And we need to treat the individual person and their unique root cause. Food as medicine. Food was supposed to be nutritious, and it was supposed to be healing before it became toxic. No supplement or medication can overpower a poor diet. So everything, supplements can help, and exercise can help, and medication can help at times, but we must eat properly. We do custom blended herbal therapy, personalized dietary supplements as needed, personalized exercise plan, and we teach people how to meditate. So this is a big part of my practice. Visceral manipulation is part of osteopathic manipulative therapy. I'm a doctor of osteopathic medicine, and it is a gentle manual therapy that addresses the relationships between the organs and their adjacent structures. The point of osteopathy, of all osteopathy, including visceral manipulation, including cranial osteopathy, is that structure is closely associated to function of the organ. And in order for the organ to function properly, it must be in the proper, without restrictions, and its proper motion. So we do lymphatic drainage, which I don't have time to speak about, but important thing that I tell people, your health is an investment, not an expense. Investing in your health will help you function better, help your business grow, help your personal relationships, and it is not something to take lightly. Thank you.